equation's not too terribly foreign to us. It's the kind of equation we would write especially, I guess in two instances. One, standard form, right? So we're talking about linear equations in standard form. This is a linear equation in standard form. Also, systems of equations. Oftentimes, the equations are in this form, in standard form. And if, I guess, earrings are $8, let's see. Does it specify? Earrings, headbands. Okay, so earrings are X and headbands are Y. So if earrings are X, the number of earrings are X, or pairs of earrings are X, then they must cost $8 each, and then $4 each for a headband, Y being the number of headbands, and whatever X and Y are, they need to add 24. Equation in function form. So function form would look like a factory. Like it has like an in door and an out door. Okay. And the out door usually is called by what in this equation? Which letter usually represents the output?
Y.
Y does represent the output. So we want to write it so that the factory stuff is all over here, all the inner workings and the cogs and the belts and the conveyor lines and rollers is all over here. And the equals to is just the output. You know, it's just whatever you do on the one side, you got it. You got the output because that's what Y is. So in order to do that, we need to get Y by itself. So we subtract 8X from both sides. Okay, so we have negative, I guess we'll have it in between step here, and 4y equals negative 8x plus 24. Then we divide by 4, negative 2x plus 6. Now it's in function form. Okay. It's got all the inner workings on the right side. Once you get done with the right side, that's what the output is, as opposed to putting the input there, having to solve for the output every time.
What can you do, because what I did was divide by 4 on, for both of the 8x and 4y.
And you wind up with y equals negative 2x plus 6, or 6 minus 2x.
Yeah, because I turned out 2x plus y equals 6 minus 2x on that side, and then y equals 6 minus 2x.
That works.
So is y always the output?
I would say like 99.9% of the time, and there's always an exception to the rule, right? But
yeah.
Usually, yes.
Okay.
Just your standard x and y, y is going to be output, x is going to be
output.
Okay. For the times that it's not the output, maybe the output will be B and the input is A, because the situation just, it makes sense. Or in this situation, it might make sense to use E and H for earrings and headbands, so the letters can be whatever. But if you see an equation that has an x and y, they say put it in function form, then y is your output. So given a number of headbands, we can figure out the number of earrings that go along with that number of headbands. So I guess we did that part A, find the domain and range. So the domain and range are all the things that would make sense, okay, or that are possible to put into this function. So those values that would make sense for x would be realistic, believable numbers of what?
Input.
What does the input represent?
The number of earrings.
Oh, did I get this backwards? Earrings is x.
Yeah.
No, it's backwards. So earrings is x and headbands is y. So if x represents earrings, pairs of earrings, then what numbers would be believable, would make sense? You're gonna buy some earrings. How many earrings might you buy? Pairs of earrings. Richard?
0, 1, 2, and 3.
0, 1, 2, and 3. Why not 4?
Because if you had 4, well, you couldn't have 4 because, you only have $24, so you can't get that much earring unless you're in debt.
So you can't get 4 earrings.
Mm-hmm.
Because 4 earrings would be what?
Going over your budget.
4 times 8.
Oh, yeah.
No,
4 times 8
is 32. And so, yeah, it would be over budget. If we looked at it in function form, then negative 2 times 4 would be?
Negative 16.
Negative 2 times 4?
Oh, sorry, negative.
Right, we're thinking about 4 being allowed for x.
Mm-hmm.
Negative 2 times 4 is negative 8.
Mm-hmm.
And this tells me how many headbands I'd have to buy. How many headbands do I have to buy? Y equals
negative 2.
Yeah, could I buy negative 2 headbands?
No.
Nope.
Okay, so I like the way you're thinking. How? What would negative mean? It would mean I'd have to sell this vendor 2 headbands, return them if I had previously bought them. Okay. Of course, that's not really something we can do. It doesn't tell us we have headbands to exchange, but that is what negative 2 headbands would mean. I would have to give them 2 headbands plus my $24, and then I can take away 4 headbands. So, but let's just say no. We're not going to think about, we're not going to entertain the idea of having negative headbands and negative earrings. Okay? So then the realistic outputs would be, well, what if the outputs that go along with those inputs, right? How would we find these outputs?
You'd plug in those x equals and then plug those into y.
Just the, you know, simple input output situation. Input 0, if I input 0, I'll get 6. If I input 1, what will I get?
4.
And I could buy 4, what is that, headbands. Y is headbands. If I were to buy 2 earrings, well, that'd be 2 negative 2 is 4, 6 times 4 is 2. Okay? If I were to buy 3, that would be 6 minus 6, that would be, well, I would buy 0 then. So there's the realistic domain and range of both of these, well, of this function. Okay. Which one is this, the domain or the range?
Domain.
The domain. Remember we talked about the inputs, all the things you put in. It's given the, you know, I don't have a really good explanation. I think you could even explain to yourself why the input's called the input and the output's called the output, right? Okay. And why a function might be called a function. But why the domain is called the domain and the range is called the range? There's not like a really simple way of thinking about that, so it's a little bit of a memorization. Domain, it's a set of all the inputs. And the range, it's a set of all of the outputs. And our domain and range right there. 0, 2, 3, 6, 4, 2, 0. And we kind of already talked about this with x possibly being 4. Why can't x be 6?
The same thing.
We'd have to have a negative amount of headbands, which means I'd have to have some amount of headbands to trade in, make sure I have my receipt. The tags are still on the headbands and all that kind of stuff, but it doesn't say that we have that. So there's our domain and range. There's our, without having to write all that down, part C would be, you know, can't have negative headbands. Well, we'll look at 4, 5, or 6. So we have points at -2, -2. There's one at -1, 0. And there's one at
2, 0, 2. Yeah.
1, 0, and 2, -2. Scales and the maxes are a little off. Okay, so there are 5 points.
Mm-hmm.
Question is, what's the domain and range? Remember that the domain is just a list of numbers. Really, not in any particular order. Okay? As long as you write down all the numbers that are in the domain, then you've written down the domain. Now, The domain is a set of all, set of all what?
Input, all of the inputs.
Okay. So what Kyle asked earlier is why always the always the output, and what did I say?
99.9%.
Yeah. So pretty much always yes. Y is the output, which means that what's the input?
X.
X. Which of these is telling me what X is? Which one is telling me what X is?
The X axis.
The X axis. The horizontal axis. And the vertical one tells me what Y is. Listening to the domain range, I don't really have to pair up this input with this output. I just need to list all the inputs and outputs. So what inputs are there? What values does X have?
Negative 2.
2.
Negative 1.
Negative 1. Right? That point has an input of negative 1.
0.
0. There's that point has an input of 0.
1 and 2.
2. This one has an input of 1. This one has an input of 2. Okay, so we have 5 different inputs. When we look at the range, we're just going to list all of the things that the function has as output. Okay, so what values does it output? I just have to look at each point and look at the input and output, right? This is negative 2, negative 2. The input's negative 2, right? It's already there on our list of inputs in the domain.
And that's the same for 2.
Negative 1, 0. What's the same for 2?
The negative 2, because they're both on the same line.
Okay, so they both have an output of negative 2, right? And I don't have to list negative 2 twice in the range. I just have to tell you that that is an output. Again, the domain is just a list of numbers. It's not in a particular order. It doesn't necessarily get paired up with its input. It doesn't have to do that. We just have to list what those numbers are. So set of all the outputs, well, one of the outputs is negative 2. What's another output that it has? What's another one that it has?
2.
2. Okay, so this one is 0, 2. Yeah. This one's 1, 0. And this one's 2, negative 2. So this has an output of 0. I already have 0 listed. It's on the list already. Okay. You're like, if I was going to the store, the woman told me to get bananas, and later she said bananas again, I wouldn't list bananas twice. I know that she wants me to get bananas, she just happened to say it twice, right?
Correct.
So it's already on the list. And we don't have to write it. Negative 2 shows up. Again, it's already on the list. So list complete. The list of all the outputs is complete. We don't have to worry about writing them multiple times. So again, domain and range, just a list of numbers. They do not necessarily pair up in particular way. What about the, now there's a negative 2 and there's a negative 2 again. Does that seem to violate the definition of a function?
There's negative 2 and negative. No, actually, wouldn't that be a relation if it added? Oh no, that wouldn't be, because it'd only be if there was two answers for negative 2, like two outputs for negative 2, then that'd be a relation. But you can't have the same one for domain and range.
I think I know what you're saying. The same one for domain and range.
Like you can have the exact same input and exact same output. And that would not be a relation, because that's not having two different outputs.
Okay, I agree. Let's take it back all the way to the beginning of the question and see if we can bring everybody along. Why might I feel like, if I'm learning this for the first time, that this violates, the definition of a function comes in two parts, right? What part would it feel like if maybe it kind of violates the definition of a function?
If there was more range, if there is more than one range for a one domain, like one input.
Okay, so let's just clear up some words for a second. The domain is a bunch of numbers together.
Well, I mean, if there's like one input and there's two outputs.
So if the one input had
two or more outputs.
Anything other than one, right?
Yeah.
Or even zero outputs. There'd be no way to put a point here so that there was no input and no output, right? Once you have one point somewhere on there, it has two things.
Yeah.
So we're not going to get that problem. But if we did have an input that had two outputs, then we would have a problem. But two inputs sharing the output is not a problem. What would this graph look like if there was an input that had two outputs, and would there therefore not be, then therefore not be functional?
It'd be a relation.
But what would this graph look like? How would you describe this graph? What might you add on to this graph, adjust this graph, so that it wasn't a function, so it violated that second part? Clint?
It could be like a 1,
1,
or 2, 0.
2, so here we have a 2, negative 2, and we also have a 2, 0. That right there makes it not a function, violates the very definition of a function, because there is an input with more than one output. Remember, like, let's all turn to our notes, or if you can recall what this part says. Let's take a quick second and turn there real quick.
Like, what's the word for it?
I just want to look at the wording. I want to read the wording and see how we'll erase that point. Clint is right. That is what we're looking at a function. But even though you see negative 2 show up as an output twice, that's okay. Let's read the wording that we wrote down last time. The wording should say every input has what?
Exactly one output.
Exactly one output. One output exactly. Okay, let's look at every input and see if that fits that definition. Let's look at this input of negative 2. Does it have one input exactly? Negative 2, negative 2. Let's look for other outputs. No outputs here. Okay, it looks fine. Here's another input, negative 1. Does it have exactly one output?
Yes.
0 is the only output that it has. 0 input has only the output 2. The input 1 has only the output 0. The input 2 has only the output negative 2. So yeah, we checked all of the inputs, all 5 of them. They all exactly have one output. And that may, you may get tripped up on that even still, even though we've gone over it. But I wanted to cover it, because that is something that trips people up. They're like, oh wait, this is going to function, because look, that one has a negative 2, and that one has a negative 2. Okay. But one quick thing on a graph, at least, when Clint said the point 2, 0 would make this not a function, okay, because 2 now has the output of negative 2 and has the output of 0. What do you notice about these two points?
They're on the same line.
They are, like, vertically, right? Like a vertical line would just cross through both of those points. If you can draw a vertical line on a graph and it crosses through the graph twice or more times, you have not a function. Not a function. Like, so here we have a circle, and there are certainly ways to get circles to appear on the xy-axis, but what is this not?
A function.
A function. Guys, let's take this guy for instance. Let's say it's the point 1, 2. Okay. Well, there's also this point down here. Let's say it's 1,
negative 2.
Negative 2.
Oh yeah.
So, you know, circles have this symmetry. So, not a function. So, you can get graphs that are circles, but there's an equation that makes that circle appear, but whatever that equation is, it's not a function. And that graph is not a function. There are multiple outputs for every input. Let's see, so the graph, number, I think you said 8, just did you get it?
Yeah.
You guys are all familiar with parking meters, right?
Mm-hmm.
We've all been downtown, haven't we?
Mm-hmm.
Downtown
is a money into it for a certain amount of time.
Yeah, so if I put in a quarter, I get so much time. If I put in 2 quarters, I get twice as much time. If I put in another quarter,
you get 3 times as much
as 1 quarter.
No, there's more.
Well, depends on what you're talking about. Am I referencing the 1 quarter, then it's 3 times as much. If I reference the 2 quarters, I'm actually getting 1/2 as much as the 2 quarters. Right, 1/2 more.
Yeah.
It increases by 50%. So, it doesn't really outline it. No, it doesn't really say. Okay.
It just goes to independent variables.
Yeah. So, I mean, there's these two words, independent. Independent and dependent.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see if we know what the words of dependent and independent mean. What does independent mean?
Well, it doesn't depend on anything.
Yeah, it's just free, like free to be whatever, right? As we talk about, you know, people say we have independence. That's what they're saying. Like, I can be whatever I want to be. I can do whatever I want to do. I have independence, and there's nothing that can stop, right? And then there's dependence. Dependent, something that is dependent on something else, relies on that other thing in order to change, right? Okay, so when I think about the quarters that I put in and the time that comes out, okay, which of those things is free to change at will and which one has to have the other to change?
The quarters are independent because you can put in as much as you want, but the time is dependent because that, like, relies on the quarters.
Right. Now you might say the quarters are independent, they rely on you to put them in, but you're not part of the function. The function is the part of you. So the dependent thing is the time. The time cannot change until a quarter goes into the machine. Okay? And if you could take a quarter out of that machine, like out of that machine, it can't, other than time, go down. But the time can't change without a quarter going in. And the time can't, you know, the parking meter can't just sit there and be like, I'm going to increase in time, and that's going to cause a quarter to come into the parking meter. Doesn't work that way. The parking meter just sits there, it waits, it depends on you, to put a quarter into it before the time can change. One thing causes another thing to change. You know, the thing that causing the changing is independent, and the thing being changed is dependent.
Yeah, so where do all like the coins and stuff go when you put in the part of the meter?
The assigned value enters and sent to the courthouse.
It just a person with a key comes by and takes the quarters out.
Or someone breaks them in, you know.
Oh, yes, but nowadays, have you been downtown recently?
Yeah.
There are no more parking meters.
Yeah.
Well, maybe in certain spots. But
like,
man,
they changed them out.
They've changed them out. So, yeah, you have, so depending on how far away you park from this thing, you have to walk down to the thing, enter your license plate, you know, swipe your card, or enter insert bills.
That's
a care of that way. Kind of a bugger.
Can't steal. That's a bummer.
Can't steal.
Yeah, I'm like, the old ones are better.
Well, they're definitely old timey and fun. Here's what we have. I like the one where you crank it, the little dial comes up.
Oh, yeah.
And you don't have to give them your license plate number.
Huh?
And you don't have to give them your license plate number.
Well, either way, the person who comes by and gives you tickets is going to write down your license plate.
Yeah, but even if you don't get a ticket, I guess. I don't know.
Well, anyway,
kind of weird.
So independent, dependent. The thing that causes the change is the independent. It is in control. It's the one that's causing the change. The dependent is the one that doesn't have any power. It just sits there and waits for the other thing to come along and change it. So even in the school, I can think of a few examples that are even just like a parking meter.
The school lunch thing, where you have to put in money, but you can put in any amount of money for lunch, but it's dependent because you get a certain amount of lunches.
Okay, the number of lunches is dependent on the amount of money you put in. Yeah, you can't just get all the lunches I want without putting money in it.
Trying to buffet, you can.
Start a tab?
No, you can just like pay them a certain amount and you can get as much as you want.
Oh, I see.
Yeah,
that's
a buffet. Still, you get some.
But the number of buffets, you know, is dependent on the money. If you leave, you can come back.
You do?
And start a new buffet. If you leave the building.
Oh, okay. I thought like
who has like
the
that,
restroom.
Right? You pay them money and you get as much food as you want.
So basically, you know, you can eat there all day.
So is Huat or China Buffet, is that a function?
No, it's relation because there's more than one outlet.
Yeah, if I try to make a function, the amount of money paid and the amount of food eaten. Or at least the amount of food taken, then no, because I could pay the same amount of money and get one bowl of food or 15 bowls of food.
Yeah.
Actually, I don't know. Try and get 15 bowls of food and see if they play. That would be kind of entertaining. So, watch them 15 bowls of food. Mix this all together? Yeah, just mix it. Anyway, okay, so in the school, I can think of some functions where one thing has another, lunches, down in the gym foyer, vending machines, give it something and it gives you something, right?
Can it work with like grades though? Like if you put in your
much
homework,
effort.
Then you get a certain amount of points?
Yeah, points to grade. Yeah, like your amount of points is correlated to one grade. Now, they're, you know, a 91 and a 92 are both going to get A minuses, right?
Mm-hmm.
But that's still a function. 91 gets an A minus. There's not another output for that. 92 also gets an A minus, but again, it only has one output. So it is a function. What's the independent?
The
U.
Input, the 90,
what's
the
number grade, yeah. And the output is the letter, right? And it depends on your grade. It depends on your score. You know, if I go to the vending machine, I want to buy some chips or something. If I want to buy multiple bags of chips. Chips don't come out until I give it money. So it's kind of like, you know, just like the parking meter.
There's no credit card function.
Yeah, you can use a credit card.
Is a credit card a function?
Yeah.
It could be, depending on how you define
the bank. You put money in the bank, you just pay a check at the end of the month. That's a debit card.
But that's debit cards and credit cards are two different things.
Yeah.
I say credit card.
You just say, yeah, it could be. It just depends on how you define the variables.
Okay.
You know, what do I define the input as the money, the output as the number of items, which is what's the input. Bridger?
When are you gonna track the math test?
The ones that have been completed, I've graded. I'm not handing them back because there's still so many that haven't finished.
Okay.
That I don't want those fully in there. So I can show you those after. Well, after we're done.
Okay.
All right. I didn't really hear anybody saying anything about 9, 10, 11. It seemed like everybody's cool with that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Because you just had to plug in x and the equations to get.
Yeah, it's pretty easy.
And list the domain and range.
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay.
I know it's a lot of words, but a lot of these words just make sense for the role that they play. Input goes in, output comes out.
Mm-hmm.
Independent is kind of in control. Dependent depends on something. Domain and range doesn't make as much sense. It's just not like, oh, when I think domain, I think a bunch of numbers.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a little bit of memorization, just what the word is and what the word means doesn't exactly tell you its relationship to a function. All
right. We don't homework with you.
No, what we're gonna do? So we got a little bit of time left here, around 15 minutes, and I'm gonna give you that time too. If you wanna finish up your tests, you can finish those up. You can also finish your homework. You can finish your homework. And if you have all that done, then you can work on something else, read a book or
what?
Some music.
Oh, are we?
Perfect.